So good evening, everyone. What a joy it is to be here in Connecticut. I have had nonstop wonderful opportunities since I've been here. From this morning all the way through our experience at lunch, had a rather impromptu time of supper with some friends and colleagues, and I have an opportunity to share with you this evening. And I feel so blessed. I feel right at home. I'm not waiting to feel at home. I already feel that I am among friends and colleagues and family. And I'm deeply humbled by the opportunity to share with you. I want to talk a little bit about Pentecost. I am, as I said earlier today, unapologetically Pentecostal. And it took me a little while to get glad about that. And I say that because there are many things that are attached to my being a Pentecostal that I ran away from in my pursuit of a liberated and liberating theology. And because I understand the oppression and I understand the sin of religion, I'd like to lift up and posit in this gathering that the principal sin of religion is absoluteness. We suffer in the work of religion because everybody is absolutely right about absolutely everything. It is even problematic for those of us who consider ourselves open-minded and theologically liberal, because we believe we're absolutely right about that. Liberal fundamentalism does exist, I might add. I think it's important for me to say that my journey back to being embracing of my Pentecostal roots was just that, a journey. And it was a journey that had connected to it my coming to grips with, as I said earlier, the concomitant streams that run through me. My Pentecostal self, my UCC self. Again, they don't like each other. They don't understand each other entirely. But they have come to harmonize in beautiful and powerful ways. So during this season of Pentecost, I wanted to reflect on a few things that I believe will be transformative in our growth and in our connection as people who represent congregations, both as members, those who serve congregations, as pastors, as leaders. I also hear the sound of Pentecost in the United Church of Christ. I declare I do. I hear the sound of Pentecost. So let me go back a little bit and say to you that I was raised in the womb of the African American Pentecostal Church. My grandfather was among the original bishops under Bishop C.H. Mason in the Church of God in Christ. My uncle, who is still alive, has recently retired as the General Secretary of the Board of Bishops of the Church of God in Christ. And one of my other uncles, who has since passed, was also a bishop in the Church of God in Christ. I had many women ministers in my family, but they didn't allow us to call ourselves pastors and elders, bishops and such. They called us evangelists and missionaries. And we could preach, but we had to preach from the floor. We could never ascend. We couldn't come up the stairs and couldn't touch the pulpit, except the cleaning lady. She got a pass. The rest of us couldn't do it. And I shared with my sister a little earlier that one of the things that I confess openly, if you ever see a picture of City of Refuge, of our church, you will see that it's, for all intents and purposes, a very modern, built-out sanctuary, modern, built-out, multi-purpose use, floors and walls. The floors are all hardwood. The walls are sort of vanillaed out. They don't have anything on them that would suggest church. We bring it in, and then when we want to have a dance, we take it out, if you understand what I mean. And in our sanctuary, there's a very old and traditional pulpit, and people have asked me how come I haven't gotten a modern one. And I said, I confessed that after I lost my grandfather, I went by the church late at night with a truck. I'm making an open confession so you can hear me. And I took the pulpit, put it in my car, and I've been preaching from it ever since. Same pulpit. And so the thing that brought me fear now brings me comfort. It was a great transition. And so being raised in the womb of the African-American Pentecostal church, we received a teaching. And that teaching was we needed to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And they called it Holy Ghost. No Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost. And it was necessary, this Holy Ghost, for eternal life. You had to have it in order to get to eternal life, which, of course, had to be earned. And it's the Holy Ghost that would enable you to live a sin-free life. It was complicated because the old missionaries told us that we had to live right to get the Holy Ghost. But then we had to get the Holy Ghost to live right. And so we used to have an altar service after church, and they put the chairs out, and we would all get on our knees, and we would pray and ask God for the Holy Ghost. And if we didn't get it, and it wasn't confirmed by the altar workers, they would send us home with this idea and this suggestion that we would live right, really, really right, the next day, and then come back for prayer again and seek to get the Holy Ghost. And so I did this over consecutive nights, trying to get it. And my altar workers, their names were Jessie Mae Gatson, Mother Jessie Mae Gatson, and Mother Virgie Lee Hunter. And Mother Virgie Lee Hunter and Mother Jessie Mae Gatson prayed diligently with me over a series of nights that I would receive the Holy Ghost. And I tried and I tried. I didn't do any cussing and nothing during the daytime. Didn't slap anybody while we were playing ball or anything like that. And tried to keep my mind stayed on Jesus. And finally one night when Mother Jessie Mae Gatson and Mother Virgie Lee Hunter were praying for me, I had a bit of an out-of-body experience where for a minute I don't have any recall where I was. When I came to myself, I had rolled under the benches. Now, we had high benches. I rolled under the benches from the front all the way to the back of the church. And I had little dust bunnies all in my hair from under the benches. And I was speaking in a language that I couldn't understand. And they were standing over me saying, "That's it. Oh, happy day." I want you to know I was a happy child. And because that meant that I had had my rite of passage. And I had shifted from a seeker to a finder. I had received the Holy Ghost. And some folks in my congregation, which is made up of Baptists and Methodists and Episcopal folks and Lutheran people, but also people who practice indigenous faith. I have a Cherokee priest, and I have some folks who are Yoruba, and people who are Kolondomble, and people who are Santeria, and Jewish folks, and we have some Muslim folks. And they always ask me the same question, "So is that what I should expect?" And I said to them, "I believe that God blesses us often with the thing that we expect. And I believe that there's probably a sister or brother who is in a sweat lodge somewhere tonight waiting for a manifestation of spirit, perhaps in the form of their animal guide, and perhaps someone who is a vowed whirling dervish is whirling somewhere, speaking the words of Rumi, and waiting for a manifestation of their spirit guide. I don't know that God has to give us manifestations, but sometimes manifestations are what we need to believe that something powerful has happened in our lives. Maybe it's a sunset, hallelujah. Maybe it's a whale that breaches when you call on your Orisha. But whatever may be your reality, in the Pentecostal church, that was what we waited for. And when I got it, they pulled me up off the floor and a great celebration happened all over the church. I said, "Thank God, no more Terry service after church for me." But on my journey, it begs a question, because they thought it was what was needed for eternal life. Something apparently happened in Acts 2. Acts 2 and 4, and perhaps Acts 2:38. These are familiar passages, and I'm sure that you've been reading from them during this Pentecost season. What was the purpose of what happened, Acts 2? And what happened, really, on that day? So I'd like to share a few things that I believe I heard, and I want to bless you as it has blessed me. Purpose one, perhaps the coming of the Spirit was to address what is still the greatest challenge of religion. I said to you that I believe the greatest sin of religion is absolutism. And let me go a little further and say that if I am really for real, a dyed-in-the-wool Methodist, and I mean really a dyed-in-the-wool Methodist, such that perhaps my mother was a Methodist, my father was a Methodist, my grandparents were Methodists, and you, bless your heart, are a Lutheran, then there is something often in my psyche that will have pity, feel sorry for you, bless your heart, that you're a Lutheran, and I will tolerate you at the annual interfaith service for about an hour and a half. And then I want to get away from you and get back to the people with whom I am culturally and theologically comfortable. You understand me, right? Such is the absolutism of religion. And it is a great challenge. So I'd like to posit that the first purpose, perhaps on that day, was to get them together. This, my beloved, for people of faith, is a miracle. Let me say it again. This, my beloved, for people of faith, continues to be a miracle. We wear as a badge of honor our heritage in religion. These pews were purchased by my great, great, great grandparents. And this is our window. And even when we're not here, you will have to check with us to find out if you can sit in my family's pew. I would venture to say about 80% of religion is culture. I used to say 60%, but I'm going a little further now and say that there's about 80% that is culture. Let me say it another way. In my worship experience at City of Refuge in Oakland, we clap on the 2 and the 4. We have a full drum set. We have several tambourines. We have a B3 jazz organ and a small baby grand piano and wood floors. So you can sort of guess the rest. When we go in musically, we go all the way in. And we dance at any given time, impromptu. It's not on the script. It's not written in the program. Just because somebody's feet get glad, we, bam, we hit the floor. First time that I went to Africa, particularly South Africa, where people speak Zulu, Sotho, and many of the other languages that I don't know, but when they sang and when they danced, everything in me went home. Because I understand culture. The culture of the church has to do with our bells and smells and what it means to us. Let me go a step further. When I was a kid coming along, we had a sister in the church named Mother Bertha Robinson. And Mother Bertha Robinson was the one who took care of the children for the church. She was our youth leader. She had one of those wood panel station wagons. Some of us remember that. And she used to let us eat our hot dogs and drop mustard and relish all inside her station wagon, and she didn't care. She was in the church kitchen every fifth Sunday. She cooked, and she sold dinners for the youth department. Problem was, Mother Bertha couldn't cook. She couldn't cook. She was one of those people that when she fried chicken, it was bleeding at the bone and burned on the outside. She just couldn't get it together. Her pound cake was kind of salty to the taste. It's like, and dry. And so, but she would sell more dinners than anybody. Because people would come by and they'd say, oh no, Mother, you keep the dinner. I'll just make a donation. And it worked like a charm, Mother Bertha Robinson. And over the years, I've asked the question, because the 20-plus years that I was there at the church with my grandparents and my parents, Mother Bertha's cakes never improved. And when she died, her last cake that she cooked was one of those kind of cakes. And it begs the question, what is a 20-plus-year-old bad cake? It's a bad cake. It's just an old bad cake. And there are some of the things that we do that are custom, how am I doing with this, that are tradition for us, that we have come to love simply because it's what we do. And if we were to really tell the truth, we don't know why, we don't know where it began, we don't know why we have to do it, we really don't like it, but we do it because it is what we do. And we do what we do. One of the greatest mysteries to me 20 years ago coming into the United Church of Christ was the incredible amount of time that we can have meetings. I thought it was outstanding. And the church would criticize us for how long we have worship, and we couldn't get it. And said, we have long worship. And it said, and I said, and you all want to get through 45 minutes to an hour, you out. If your body's not gone, your heart and head is gone. You know, sometimes it's just like, that's long enough. Let's go, you know. But we can meet. And when I realized how much we can meet, we met before the meeting. We met at the meeting. We had caucuses during the meeting in the hallway. We had a meeting after the meeting. And late, way late, midnight, 1 o'clock, we had another meeting on the meeting that we had after the meeting. Anybody understand what I'm saying, right? It is the culture of the United Church of Christ. The great miracle, my beloved, is that it's not a question of right or wrong. It's a question of how we're acculturated. So before the Holy Spirit could really be poured out on the church in Acts 2, the church had to be moved to be with one accord in some kind of harmonious union, perhaps simply a unity of purpose, not so much a unity of practice. A unity of purpose to be with one accord in prayer and supplication, asking God for a revelation of God's will. And one writer said, the blessed dove, referring to the Holy Spirit, will do a flyover and will not light on a people who are perpetually embroiled in strife. Essentially, the Holy Spirit perhaps retreats from disunity and disharmony, retreats from absolutism and authoritarianism, these twin sins of religion. And there are those who say that miraculous things could not have happened on the day of Pentecost the way it was written in Acts 2. And they would like very much to take everything about anything supernatural out of the experience, especially all that wind and fire and tongues, etc. There are those who would say, whatever I cannot believe, in all probability, did not happen. But I come from a people for whom miracles and manifestations and visions and dreams and signs do not take us by surprise. But I want to say again, the true miracle, and the one most important and perhaps the least observed and most seldom debated, was the miracle of their being with one accord in one place. Apparently, none of the miracles could have occurred had they not found a path to unity. Unity doesn't mean sameness, but I believe it means sameness of purpose and intent. Jesus was very clear that they would have to go to Jerusalem, they'd have to wait together, they'd have to wait together, how about this, upstairs in this apartment. Now, I've been to Palestine. This is a hot place. No air conditioning. Upstairs in this apartment until a thing happened. Now, imagine Jesus telling us that. I'm going to leave, and I'm going to send you out of Jerusalem, and I want you to go there and wait until the thing happens. Somebody says, so what thing? The thing. Well, you're going to have to break that thing down to me. And who's going to be in charge of the meeting? Who's going to be in charge of Robert's Rules of Order? We got to have that. She said, no, go and wait until the thing occurs for you. Because the wonder was not in the thing. The wonder was in what happened while they were waiting for the thing to occur. And I wonder what it took to get them unified. Intersectional in purpose and intent and in goals. This group, rich, poor, Jews, Gentiles, men, women, and somebody had to be gay. They just didn't write about it. But I promise you that is one, at least 10 to 15% of the people in the room had to be gay. Common oppression, all of them guilty by association. They had common loss because you can never go back once you come out. They had been marginalized by their association with Jesus. They'd been marked. They'd been talked about, but they had also had common miraculous experience. And can I say, I don't know what your miraculous experience is. I have no idea what your miraculous experience has been. But I want to say this to you, never for the sake of tranquility or the desire to be accepted and appreciated by others, never allow anyone to make you deny or demean the authenticity of your experience with the divine. Never let it happen, ever in life. They had had some experiences with the divine. So perhaps this present atmosphere, when so many sisters and brothers of our intersectional freedoms are in danger, perhaps it is time for us to have an upper room experience. Perhaps we need to stay together long enough, talk together long enough, witness together long enough until we can find those intersectional needs that all of us need to have addressed. And if your stuff is not specific to the justice that I need, perhaps we can get together and you can bring yours and I can bring mine and we can connect them together and not allow people to drive wedges between us because we have different needs. Now, you may not be a walking justice issue like me. I'm a walking justice issue. Woman clergy, I'm African American, I'm same gender loving, I'm short. There's a walking justice issue. Do you understand? Just a laundry list of things going on all at the same time. I understand that. But whatever are your needs, whatever are your realities, we need to blend them together such that when we come out of upper room experiences like this, that I'm under your load with you, and you're under my load with me. Now, it's kind of like chitlins. Let me tell you why. Because you can't come into chitlins late in life. I can't explain it to you. You would have had to have a grandmother like mine and a mother like mine who knew how to make chitlins, and they could clean them and they could make them, and we would come running because they were so good, and you had to have Louisiana hot sauce. It had to be the right hot sauce, right amount of bell pepper and garlic and seasoned salt in the chitlins to make the chitlins really right. I can't explain it to you, and you can't come into them late in life. And if you don't know what they are, ask somebody around you, and they'll share with you. But I also can't come into haggis. A kimchi. I tried. In Korea, in Seoul, where the real kimchi is, I don't understand how you all can eat anything that smells like this. I can't get it. I don't understand it. But when you're raised on a thing, it's different to you when you're raised on it. And I don't know, or if you live long enough in a society that your needs are peculiar to your life and to that of your community, then you understand But even if you weren't raised on it, if it hasn't been your experience, what the Spirit can do is bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. And then we can confront the common evil that comes against our inalienable rights to justice and freedom and respect and equality. We can do that with and for each other, with and for each other through the Holy Ghost, as my grandmother would say. Let me go a little further. It's the second purpose. There's only three. The second purpose, to get everybody's attention and to out intersectional justice warriors so that you know why I'm here. I am here to out you. Come out wherever you are. Because peaceful people are too quiet. Too peaceful. Come out. They needed to get everyone's attention. These people who had been privately with Jesus, who you know did most of his work in the suburbs, he pushed back against coming into Jerusalem because he knew that death was there. That right after throwing down the palm fronds and singing Hosanna, in just a few days they would be saying, crucify him. He knew that death was there. And he didn't come back to Jerusalem until the appointed time. And they spent their time with him out in the burbs, out in the meso-urban, suburban areas. Then he raised Lazarus from the dead, and the word got out. The Greeks wanted to know how to do it so they could market it. The high priest wanted to know what they could do to shut him down because they knew that the whole world would begin to follow him. And the Jewish sisters and brothers were trying very hard to see if this was the response of the eternal that he was going to take David's throne. Here he was. Here was the answer to the question, what was the purpose? The purpose of Pentecost was to prepare the disciples to do the finished work. Now, I'll be honest, I have often wondered when I take a look at the life of Jesus, whose disciple I am, I often wonder what did he mean if it is true what was attributed to him when he said, essentially, I've done great things, but greater things will you do? And I asked the question in my heart, how can we conceivably do greater things? Because I can't imagine what greater thing could possibly be done. But what is clear to me as I go on in life is that we have some responsibility to finish this, for as much finishing is necessary in our lifetime. See, I'm really having some difficulty with apocalyptic eschatology. I started having this problem about 3 or 4 years ago. And I remember when the leader of Family Radio, some of you all know, said that it would happen, the second coming, would come in May, the 21st of May. And it didn't happen, and it would come again in October of that year. And then over in the spring of the following year, he died. And I remember having that feeling that apocalyptic eschatology that somehow says that all the fixing is going to be done by this super mad and pissed off Jesus. Anybody understand me? That's on his way back to blow the whole thing to hell. That's the intent. This angry, vengeful, pissed off, unpredictable, scattershot, acts like an alcoholic father, is on his way back to do horrible things to creation. I started having some problems with that because it helps us to abdicate our responsibility to bring the kingdom. Come on now. If he's going to come back and blow it all up, then what is my job to work for it? What is my job to make it happen? And I started talking about this in black churches, and I got in trouble in lots of places. Because our eschatology was our deliverance. See, we wrote songs like, I got shoes, you got shoes, all of God cheering, got shoes. And when I get to heaven, I'm going to put on my shoes, because the earth was hell for us. Everything was in the by and by. But you know, I'm really clear that God is holding us responsible for the here and now. And we have to be outed as justice warriors and stop making other people responsible to bring the kingdom of God into the now. Not what are they doing, but what are you doing? Oh, God. People say, well, you know, I pray and I send money. And I appreciate your money. I'll leave you an address. I appreciate that. I do. But what is really the question is, how much skin do we have in the game? What do I mean by that? What kind of risk-taking have we done? In what ways have we placed ourselves in harm's way? What do we believe enough not just to live for it, but what do we believe enough that we would die for it? Because if you go all the way there and work your way back, hallelujah, then you will know whether or not you have really been outed as an intersectional justice warrior. We'll go a little further. The sights and sounds of the day of Pentecost alerted people to an unusual event. It brought them together to witness that something new and unusual was occurring. The sights and sounds of Pentecost brought representation from all over the known world to gather with the 12 apostles and to witness what was coming from the upper room. And it suggests that the events of Pentecost were for wide broadcast. United Church of Christ, I believe it is time for wide broadcast. Wide broadcast. Wide broadcast. I'm so sick of the way that all you see in the news is broadcast about things that are dysfunctional, are wicked, evil, and it's an overrepresentation often of the facts. I'm born and raised in San Francisco. We have earthquakes. In the Loma Prieta earthquake that happened in the late 80s, my friends call me from all over the country and wanted to know if we had survived. Did you survive? Because the way that the news represented our earthquake, they thought certainly that California had broken off and fallen into the Pacific Ocean. Because there's a certain sensationalism. How am I doing with that? That's attached to the broadcast of tragedy and bad news and Donald Trump. That took care of his campaign for free because of the ways in which it was broadcast. How am I doing? And also got the world's attention because it made people watch. And when people watch, then the news folks get paid. But the question that I have and continue to have is, where is our broad, wide broadcasting and the noise that we need to make about the importance of justice running down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream? And I'm challenging all of the aged out hippies. I'm talking to you. Go in the attic and get your signs down. Resole your Birkenstocks and let's get out there and do what we need to do until freedom rings. Make some loud noise about it. Somebody said, well, I believe what I believe privately. So Jesus gave them the blessing privately. Some of you all may know about this. In John 20, the evening of the resurrection, Jesus gathered the disciples at one of the apostles' house, and the text says that the same day at evening, the beginning of the week, the doors were shut and the disciples were assembled, John 20:19. It says, and they came together from their homes for fear of the Jews. And Jesus came and stood in the midst of them and said, peace be unto you. He showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said again, peace be unto you. God has sent me, so I send you. And when he said this, he breathed. And he said, receive the Holy Spirit. And someone asked the question that if he breathed on them in that private setting, why did they have to go to Jerusalem? Because you're being filled with the Spirit of God, the presence of God, the love of God, and the peace of God of necessity must not be a private event. It's important that you come out. Spirit-filled people need to come out and make some noise about this God of love and this God of peace and this God of power. And some people get accused of chasing down reporters. But I said, you know, I want people to come to our churches and film us. Westboro Baptist Church said that they were coming to San Francisco and they were looking for us because they heard we had a bunch of gay people. And they said, we're going to come there and we're going to have a demonstration outside of your church. I said, well, thank the Lord. I said, hold on just a minute. Let me get in touch with my news people. I said, I'm going to send to Oakland and get 2 truckloads of transgenders. And I want them to dress up in their RuPaul finest. And we will meet you on the corner. And we'll see which one of us get the most coverage. We'll see how this works. So bring your hateful self on the City of Refuge. They didn't come. I wish to God they had come. I wish to God the opportunity to be able to share with that kind of hateful group of people the love of God and how it manifests bodily in people who have customarily been rejected by church and religion, the opportunity to do that. I want you, where's my brother? It flicked my beak. Where's my brother that asked me that question? It's just to have the chance to have a counter protest that spoke to the love of God. The day of Pentecost, these people from 18 different regions of the world were called together to be present at this event. Faces could be seen, different races, different colors, different tribes, different faiths, alerted by the sound of a rushing mighty wind. United Church of Christ, I believe the world is listening to this historic Justice Church for the sound of a rushing mighty wind. And it attracted the people by the sound of the wind and the vision of tongues of fire. Pentecost is about getting the world's attention. Now, if you pass by a little apartment and you heard a hurricane coming out of the windows and people coming down with fire lit on the top of their heads, I can promise you, whatever you were doing, you would drop it. You'd pull out your cell phone, how am I doing with this? And you'd take some pictures of that thing. And it would be on Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook. It would be on YouTube. It would be on every conceivable thing that we could get it on. You'd have it periscoped and up for 45 minutes so that the people could see what you saw. Pentecost is about getting the world's attention. And God knows how to set a backdrop that will put God's will and God's purpose and God's intent on Front Street. This upcoming election is a backdrop. And I declare that we need to speak into it. Not just privately, but publicly. At every opportunity that we get. Speak into it, because this one, sisters and brothers, is a game changer. In all of my life, I've never seen anything quite like this. I said, I have never seen none of the predictable things have happened. We don't really know. We've never seen anything quite like this. And I said to someone the other day, now we need the voice of the United Church of Christ to step into this and have something to say. I'm not telegraphing to you what you need to say, because I believe that the work of the Spirit will do that. But I am saying to you, that justice does need to run down like water. And righteousness needs to run down like a mighty stream. There's a lot at risk, not just here, but all over the world, because they are listening for the sound of Pentecost, for a justice message to come from the United States that is greater than all of the continual vitriol that we have experienced in the last days. And what better church on the planet than the United Church of Christ, this dangerous denomination? I came to this denomination because you're dangerous. I had a few opportunities for some other denominational stuff, but this is a denomination of firsts. One danger after another danger. And when the church took the courage to offer full fellowship to LGBT people and marriage equality, I thought to myself, this is a really a dangerous church. And when my sisters and brothers, many of them from the Puerto Rican churches, said that they could not, there were sisters and brothers who are Puerto Rican who remained. And I said, these are some dangerous Puerto Ricans right here. And I want to also say that I said to the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries, of which 25 of those churches are all UCC churches now, I said to them, we have to bring two churches for every one that left. And we have to do it because this dangerous church took on danger for us. What am I saying to you, my beloved? I think that sound of Pentecost needs to ring in the air during this time. Ain't no justice when injustice has taken the day. But there also ain't no closet prophets. That's my Ebonics. But it's a good hashtag. Ain't no closet prophets. Come out. Come out. Get in trouble. Make trouble. Be trouble. Until righteousness runs down like water. Justice like water. Righteousness like a mighty stream. And then take this with you. And let me point you back to the text where it speaks of the one blessed result that I want to leave with you most strongly. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, when I was taking my preaching classes in seminary, my preaching teacher talked to us a lot about being exegetical. I love seminary words, you know, because all the seminarians know the seminary words. Exegesis, eisegesis, hermeneutics. I think sometimes, what if we named our kids that? Come here. Come here, exegesis. Go get your brother eisegesis and your cousin hermeneutics. Herman for short, right? They said to us, the important thing is to exegete the text. Get underneath, find the historical, critical realities, the analysis, so that you can stay as true to the text and work and respect the word, you understand, and treat it with respect and handle it with integrity. But I believe that the Spirit had to empower these apostles and disciples not to exegete the text because they didn't have one. They were writing it with their lives. Anybody hear me? They had the Hebrew Bible, but they were doing the Acts of the Apostles. So there was no New Testament. They were the New Testament in the flesh. So in order for them to do the work, they had to exegete the hearers. And their ability to exegete the hearers was directly connected to the Spirit's empowerment. How can you preach to me How can I preach to you? How can I talk to you? How can I share with you if we have not had a common experience? The only way I can do it is if God empowers me to do it. And there's been many a brother or sister, when we were in the gutters doing work in San Francisco, who, when we were talking to them about the love of God, was completely inebriated with alcohol or high on crystal meth. I've never ever used crystal meth. I know quite a bit about alcohol, but I had never used crystal meth. I don't know what it does to you, but I know that the Holy Spirit can enable you to speak into someone whose life experience is completely different from yours. And they began to speak, and I don't know whether the anointing came out of them or the anointing was on the ears of the hearer. But I do know by the reading of the text that the way that they spoke it, the hearers understood it. Not only did they understand it, but they received it. I am a African-American with some Cherokee and Irish blood, raised in the African-American Pentecostal tradition. I am in Hartford, Connecticut. In Yale country. Yeehaw, that's where I am right now. And preaching and teaching and sharing, and I can palpably and tangibly feel the love of God coming out of you and pouring into me. And I believe you can feel the love of God coming out of me and pouring into you. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can do that work. So how can we make the message hearable? We need the Spirit, the power of God, to help us exegete people whose life experiences we have never, ever, ever experienced in life. I don't know how to knit. I can't make quilts. I don't know any of those things. But I do know this. I know that God can speak to my heart for your heart and speak to your heart for my heart. Oh, I've seen it happen. Time and again. The exercise of sharing the love of God without having to quote scriptures, without having to do church speak, without having to share something that's been written, perhaps Spirit will give you something that's not yet been written, because God is still speaking. I think the greatest mistake of the church was to put a back cover on the book. I get in trouble for that too. But I believe that there are some things that God is saying and saying now. And I said to my congregation, if Paul's letter from a Philippian jail could be made an epistle, then Martin Luther King's letter from a Birmingham jail could be made one too. Because there are things that God is still speaking. So here it is. It's not about a private anointing. It's about coming down the stairs, coming out of the cloister, coming out of our beautiful, especially these incredible, beautiful New England steepled churches. They're just incredible, but we got to come down the stairs. And we've got to get into the street and away from the walls of private religion and start speaking the language of the people. Feeling the vibe of the people, taking up the causes of the people, and being on the front line of change. These disciples were given power over division, over disunity, over embarrassment, and a lot of what is division in the church comes from the discontent of our not using our energy for the reason that God has given it to us. Church fights happen because church people are not doing kingdom work. What we're doing is expending our energy trying to sustain an institution. It takes a lot of energy to sustain an institution, but if you take that energy and turn it outward, hallelujah, and start doing the work in the street, you don't have to worry so much about bricks and mortar. God will take care of the bricks and mortar as we take care of the work of ministry. Get over it. Get beyond it. Move past it so that we can do what we are called to do. In preparation for the cost of the call. What is the preparation for the cost of the call? Getting over disunity, over embarrassment, and receiving power. To do what? To love mercy and to do justice and to love our neighbors as ourselves. So I declare that this room is an upper room. Right now, this is an upper room. Right now, in this room, there's about this many folks that were in there, maybe a little bit more. This is an upper room. I declare that this room is an upper room. And this is the blessing of the Spirit baptism right now in this place. How will it manifest? Well, it depends on your expectation. But I do know that this place right here, right now, in this annual meeting and in this gathering, is holy unto God. And preparation is being made to do dangerous work in all of the places that we are from. God bless you is my prayer. God bless you. Thank you, brothers and sisters.